We're about to head to the mysterious Himalayan kingdom of Tibet, an expedition, the first whitewater rafting expedition ever to pass right through that country. It was an expedition that became my first documentary, aired by National Geographic straight afterwards. Here are highlights in this episode of Travelogues. G'day and welcome. I'm Greg Granger.
The huge ice flow that leads to Mount Everest has been the starting point for many successful and ill-fated climbs of the world's highest peak. For me, following in the footsteps of great explorers like George Maury and Andrew Irvine was truly inspirational. They disappeared in atrocious conditions near the summit more than 60 years before, and I earned a new respect for them and this mountain as I gasped and gulped for air still 3,000 metres below the summit. Our purpose in climbing partway up Everest was to search for the highest possible water in which to launch our raft. But the icy conditions had frozen over the streams which tumbled off Everest. To put in at such an altitude was impossible. We agreed to descend slightly for a far more realistic place to set off.
But after a long and very frustrating wait for the weather to clear, here just below Mount Everest, at last we've decided to go in just below the Mount Everest base camp, just above 5,000 metres. The water temperature is just on zero. It's very hard to breathe at this altitude, but we're about to put in anyway.
Okay. All right, let's launch it.
This wasn't exactly the world's widest or deepest river, but it was the highest. After all, we were out to set a new world altitude rafting record, no matter how small the river volume. Technically, it was highly demanding and very exhausting at such an altitude. For a full day, we kept up this crazy process. It was mountain madness. We'd made our point, achieved a world first, and now set our sights on the far bigger and more challenging rivers further inland. At such oxygen-starved altitudes, we found that just breathing was an effort. Pumping up a raft, well, that was a huge exertion. Any wonder we agreed to let the local lads have a go at the pumps. Our transport downriver for the next few weeks were 2 5-metre-long Avon rafts we'd brought with us from Australia, especially for this exercise. Large and sturdy as they were, there was barely enough room for the tonne of equipment we eventually agreed to take, every item packed in waterproof drums and bags and lashed down just in case we capsized. In the turbulent and icy waters we expected downstream, wetsuits and life jackets were going to be essential apparel, especially for our three Nepalese boatmen. This was what I'd been preparing for. Months of planning were rewarded by those first few strokes. We were underway. The vast waters of the Tsangpo carrying us into the unknown. On such breathtaking waters, bordered by freshly fallen snow, I caught sight of a most unusual craft, a coracle, a crude but effective Tibetan raft made up of dried yak hides stretched over branches. Then a beautiful experience I'll never forget. The coracle skipper serenaded us with an ancient Tibetan love song. But if the coracle men related to our mission, it was a different matter for the villagers on shore. We must have looked like men from space, padded out by bulky life jackets and bright wetsuits, wading to shore in sub-zero waters to greet them. These were memorable exchanges, their first meeting with foreigners. At their nearby village, the entire population turned out to see us. But what I'd anticipated as a friendly meeting suddenly became heavy. The village elder was highly suspicious. The last thing I'd expected was to be asked for our passports and permits. To make our stay easier, we broke the ice with a Polaroid camera, the Tibetan youngsters clamoring to see themselves on film. That evening at our campsite, the Tibetan fanaticism with the exiled Dalai Lama became very obvious. Photographs of him in books we carried were used repeatedly to bless themselves. It was their spirit of fun that really impressed us, their skill with a simple rope slingshot. Garonwy rose to the challenge. Stoning fish, well, that was a far more practical application. Back on the Tsangpo, another coracle man filled the air with an eerie Tibetan yodel. The coracle men stayed with us for several days on this calmer upper stretch of the river. But they were highly apprehensive about our plans to raft much further.
Ask them if they know what the river's like lower down.
I'm excited to see what comes up when we get to that gorge with 700-foot drop.
Yeah, that's quite a drop over that distance, and with the water narrowing so much, I think we could be in for some pretty ferocious stuff.
As we neared the unknown valleys ahead, dark thunder clouds rolled in. In this storm, we lost sight of our coracle men for an entire day, finally spotting them gliding along in a separate channel, unaware of our presence. From that reunion on, the river picked up speed quickly. We encountered our first white water, and mild as it was a hint of the far wilder rapids we expected to be swept into shortly. Later that day, we rendezvoused with our truck, our plan to visit a special city nearby. Here, we took one last journey with the coracle and its delightful paddlers. The rapids from now on would be catastrophic for such a craft, and we used the opportunity of carting it back to civilization to take a brief look at Tibet's most mysterious city before we tackled what the locals had described as the Valley of Death. The monastery at Shigatse, one of the few prominent buildings in Tibet not destroyed during the Cultural Revolution. Much to my amazement, I found that many of the 700 monks here lacked inhibition to the point of cheekiness. Body hair is something alien to the Tibetans. They found my hairy arms fascinating. They called us foreigners long noses, although I thought theirs weren't all that much shorter.
Touch their nose.
Downtown, the Shigatse marketplace was rich in characters. Among the foodstuffs on sale, huge slabs of yak butter, 3 years old.
And all of this and this, how much of this cost? I don't think I could eat any of it. Good, nice one.
We went our own way in the marketplace. Graham joined members of the proud camper race for their evening meal on the curbside. And I tried to change some money with two camper tribesmen. Such negotiations are still illegal, but these money changers went ahead and flaunted the law anyway. Elsewhere, we found small restaurants with enticing billboards. Babies wearing practical exposed pants. And evidence of the ever-present Chinese army. The streets of Shigatse are filled with exciting sounds and sights. As intrigued as we were by this place and its people, we had to move on, back to the river. The Himalayan snows were melting fast, and the waters of the Tsangpo were rising quickly to a dangerous level. From here on, we took even more precautions in loading our equipment. We were worried that the rafts could be overturned in the turbulent waters downstream and decided to double the number of ropes strapping the gear to the inflatable tubes. We'd stocked up on food for a month. There are no stores in the Tsangpo, and we had two additional passengers. One of them wore impractical high-heel shoes. Chumba and Topke were liaison officers the Tibetan authorities insisted we take, a decision we were all to regret. Underway once more. Now the surrounding mountains were steeper and closer, forcing the Tsangpo into a much narrower channel, with the river flowing much faster than before. Above us, our last sign of civilization for days. Thank you. As the tempo picked up, our Tibetan passengers began puffing incessantly on cigarettes and glancing around for reassurance. Gary and I had to constantly urge them to keep paddling.
Forward, Tundu. Okay, forward, paddle.
And at last, the cause of their apprehensions, the big water that we'd been counting on. We checked out our first large rapid very carefully.
Breaking back really hard.
Right.
I think there's a good chance of flipping in it, but we can cut just to the right of it.
Keep right, yeah.
If we come in real tight on these two rocks, we come in real tight on this rock, bow to the right,
yeah,
and catch that bridge of green water just to the right of the deepest part of the hole.
Reconnaissance over, we launched. Elated by those rapids, we pitched camp and prepared for greater whitewater challenges in the days ahead. As we were setting out on our trip, there'd been a highly publicized experiment on the Yangtze River in China. This news footage of that event showed a fully enclosed capsule being swept down through suicidal rapids. One of the Chinese occupants drowned when the current ripped the craft apart. Memories of that tragedy were still fresh in my mind when we tackled the main gorge of the Zhangpo. The Chinese government had been very apprehensive about allowing our expedition to go ahead at all in light of the Yangtze disaster, and yet we were now committed to this valley, its mountainous sides so steep that walking out would be impossible. The Zhangpo was now picking up speed every day as the valley became steeper. Most times we would tackle each stretch of white water without checking it out from land, delighting in the thrill of being seesawed up and down through the breaking waves. These were unforgettable experiences, as Garonwy recalled.
I just can't wait to get into that, the rapid, the feeling of water breaking all around, being sort of out of control, but in control. Things happening all the time, and all the time you've got to react so quickly. Steer left, steer right, maybe somebody overboard. It all happens so fast, and suddenly, pow, you're powered through, and you're out the other side, and the feelings, such a release. All your adrenaline that had built up to such a high suddenly releases and you think, I'm alive, I survived it. Wow.
For variety, we'd create our own diversions. To minimize exertion, the crew on Graham and Garonwy's raft set up a tarpaulin to use as a sail. Frequently, we raced one another, still marveling the fact that we were paddling where no man had ever rafted before, all at very high altitude. Occasionally, with a particularly large set of rapids in front of us, we'd stop to discuss the best tactics.
I think we could go straight down there,
over the stopper and ran those rocks and then straight out to the right hand side.
This set of rapids started out fine. With Richard filming from shore, I'd taken a small underwater camera to film from the bow of the second raft. That camera, with water blurring its lens, still captured one of the Tibetans, Chumba, being thrown into the rapids. Not only couldn't he swim, but the water was so cold he could have died of hypothermia within 30 seconds. We scooped him out just in time. But the damage had been done. From then on, he clung to the middle of the raft, refusing to paddle when every stroke was needed. Later, as the Tsangpo grew even wilder, Chumba deserted us altogether, choosing to walk along the cliff face after his near drowning. We named this awesome section of the valley the Washing Machine. The Tsangpo was being outright hostile, and we scouted its banks, searching for its least lethal passage. Lived up to its name, every wave tumbling us up and down. Suddenly, our raft was swept up the side of a huge wave, but with the Tibetans no longer paddling, we were badly underpowered. Our raft was almost capsized, and another Tibetan toppled overboard. This time it was Topke, but now he was being swept away quicker than our rafts. We paddled feverishly to drag him out of the freezing waters. That evening, after we bailed out our craft for the umpteenth time, we walked downstream to contemplate a huge stopper spanning the width of the Tsangpo. This was indeed a monster hole, with the chance we might never surface. We dubbed it the Grim Reaper. To test its power, we tied a life jacket to a rubber inner tube. We never saw either again. Sadly, we were forced to halt our rafting, for the moment at least. The Grim Reaper, we decided, was just too dangerous.
This is one of the most extremely serious sections of whitewater I've ever seen through this gorge. There's so much flip potential in the first two rapids. It's a continuous rapid for a kilometer, and then this hole, extending it all the way across the river without any chance of getting a raft through it.
But I think every rapid involves an element of risk. We've certainly run some big ones on this trip, but I'm afraid the risks in this one are too great. We could easily lose somebody.
We began pulling out next morning, a difficult operation as we clambered straight up a cliff face with all our rafts and equipment. With many other treacherous rapids directly below the Grim Reaper, we decided to carry our rafts overland to the nearby mystical city of Llasa. the Tibetan capital of Llasa, the original Forbidden City. Foreigners have been barred from this amazing place for most of the last few centuries, and yet here I was, rafting freely down the Kichu River to a very warm welcome. As fascinated as we were with Llasa, the Tibetans were also intrigued by us and our expedition. We were greeted by the sight of a dozen Tibetan newsmen, armed with cameras and notebooks, coming out to record our arrival. Their story, the first group to ever raft through Tibet. They scrambled onto one of our rafts to film us, and their stories were flashed all around China that night on primetime television. The potential audience, 1.2 billion people. We paddled on, the majestic Patala Palace ahead of us. The Patala dominates Llasa with its 13 stories and 1,000 rooms. Containing, as it does, the bodies of most of the Dalai Lamas, this is the world's biggest mausoleum.
It's an eerie feeling walking through the Patala Palace. This is the traditional home of the Dalai Lama, and yet he's been in exile in northern India since the Chinese occupation of Tibet in the early 50s. And despite that Chinese presence, the Tibetans are still fanatical about the Dalai Lama. Everywhere, people have been begging us for his photograph, and the Tibetans worship loudly and publicly.
In the shadows of the palace, Barkor Square, Tibet's most sacred place of worship. Thousands of pilgrims from all over the country converge on this square every week to show their devotion to Buddha. Many pilgrims throw themselves into this ritual, prostrating, praying, and moving a few steps, a process they repeat thousands of times to ensure a better reincarnation. Barkor Square and its endless stream of pilgrims is totally Tibetan. The new influx of Chinese settlers stay well away from this area. The fact that the Tibetans practice this almost fanatical worship after a 30-year Chinese ban on observing religion is a sure sign of their faith. Even the dogs are thought to be reincarnated monks who went astray in their mortal life. This deep religious conviction also allows the locals to observe an amazing ritual in the way they dispose of their dead. Dawn in Llasa. We'd travel to the northern outskirts of the city to observe an ancient practice that many cultures would describe as macabre, bizarre. We were about to see something extraordinary, a sky burial. The setting itself was eerie. From a nearby workers' compound wafted the sounds of a public address system. Directly in front of us, a huge rock slab on which was laid the body of a 35-year-old man who died of a mystery illness the day before. Systematically, a burial squad cut his body into small pieces. Every bone, the skull included, was pulverized. Watching from rocks all around, hundreds of vultures. And then the signal for those birds of prey to clean up. These amazing scenes have rarely been witnessed by foreigners, let alone filmed. The day before we'd arrived, two tourists were arrested at this site, their cameras smashed. Permission for us to film was only achieved after lengthy negotiations and a huge bribe. For the Tibetans, this procedure is their way of sending the spirit of the dead back to the gods. By eating the flesh and bones, these vultures are merely completing a cycle, death sustaining life. Back to the Tsangpo. We'd already achieved our main goals, to become the world's highest whitewater rafters and the first people ever to raft through Tibet. And now we were determined to conquer the river that had defeated us at the Grim Reaper. The new section of the Tsangpo we chose was studded with enormous rocks and deadly holes.
This rapid is a really big one, and it's important that we do a very accurate and tight run, right of center, staying out of a very big hole.
These final rapids were totally exhilarating, a fitting climax to a month of non-stop Tibetan adventure.